to the Hong Kong International Christian Church Sunday service. If this is your first time, I welcome you. If this is your second, third, fifth, I don't know how many times, we still love you and welcome you. And the sermon notes have been sent out to most of us. If it's your first time, ask the person or your neighbor to forward that email to you so you can just follow along. Wow, so people have dreams. People have a lot of awesome visions because they want to change some part of their life. And that includes me. And that's the title of today's lesson, The Power to Change. Before I was a Christian, I wanted to change in a lot of areas in my life. There were many things that I had done to the person that I had become that I wasn't really happy with. I always lied to people. And I just had a hard time trying to zip my lips, to tell the truth. But I failed many, many times. I was very, very selfish. There were so many times I had treated people badly. And then I felt so ashamed because of what I've done. And therefore, I ended the relationships. And I didn't have a vision. Well, yes, I was motivated to do the basics, to pass the exams, find a job, go to work, and pursue my selfish desires. But when it comes to helping people, nah, that wasn't me. I didn't have time for that. But all this changed when I started to learn about God. When I started to study the Bible with some Christians, when I started to go to church, when I started to pray to God, when I started to humble myself before the King. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. In verse 10, so in the email, it has all the scriptures. Verse 10 to 11. Here the Bible says, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death. See what this godly sorrow has produced in you. What earnestness, what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what alarm, what longing, what concern, what readiness to see justice done. At every point, you have proved yourselves to be innocent in this matter. Well, so here it describes two motivations that people have, worldly sorrow and godly sorrow. Well, worldly sorrow fills your life with regrets. The longer that you live, the more regrets that you have. But on the other hand, godly sorrow, it does the opposite. It leads to change, to repentance. And this godly sorrow, it turns you, anyone, any person into a passionate person. And godly sorrow makes someone who is described as earnest, eager, a person who's indignant with injustice out there. They long to be with God and do God's will, not their selfish desires. And this godly sorrow, it produces concern in a person for the lost and dark world, instead of just concerning about yourself all day, every day. And with this godly sorrow, you'll be ready to do anything for God, to go anywhere. At every point, you prove yourself to be different. No one can accuse you of being the same person that you were before you met God.
Come on.
And this is what scares most people about Christianity, because it radically changes people. That's the scariest part. I remember, it's funny, back in Chicago, when I first got baptized, I invited this friend to church, and he used to smoke and swear and all these things. And after coming to church for a couple of weeks, he stopped. And I think his girlfriend, her boyfriend. He called me up and be like, what have you done to my girlfriend? I was like, knowing God. And he was like, man, she stopped smoking, she stopped swearing, what have you done to her? And I said, whoa, isn't that like good things? But anyway, let's just leave it at that. Christianity changes people.
Yep.
And before I became a Christian, that was the change I was looking for the power to change my own life, and as a result, the lives of people around me. Is that what you're looking for today? Is that what you're looking for today?
Yes.
I know that every single one of us is here today. There's a reason. There is something that you want.
Yeah.
I mean, you wouldn't spend your time Sunday afternoon,
yeah, right,
come to church and it's super hot outside.
Yeah.
Well, I have the answer for you. The answer is God,
right,
okay,
and Jesus.
Yeah. Come on.
The answer is God and Jesus.
Come on.
And what, for me, when I truly understood that my sin hurt God, I found the motivation to change. Because I didn't want to hurt my best friend.
Come
and
on.
That's God Almighty.
Oh.
Point number one, are you in love with God?
Okay.
Let's go to John chapter 1. Are you in love with God?
Yeah.
Well, a lot of people, they describe love as a feeling. You know, that butterfly feeling in your heart. But you know what? You know what? The Bible says otherwise. John 1. Now we're going to look at how to fall in love with God. In John 1, verse 35. Here the Bible says, the next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?"
Mm.
They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you'll see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Well, so here, the only way to fall in love with God is by spending time with him.
Mm.
Well, here in this passage, Jesus, he called those who want to know him to radically change their schedules and priorities. You only fall in love with God when you make him your absolute number one priority in your life. Above your work, above your friends, above your desires, like sleeping instead of praying. Let's go to Jeremiah 29. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. And here the Bible says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." So what does it take to find God? Anyone? Can anyone tell me?
Everything.
Everything. Well, what does that mean? Well, okay.
All your heart.
All your heart. Wait, hold on. Hold on. Hey, Candace, let's talk, okay? What about 50% of my heart?
No.
Okay, can I find God? Whoa. 50%, that's a lot. Okay. 70.
No. 20.
80.
No.
Okay, 95.
100.
No.
99.
No.
100?
Yes.
Oh, that's hard. Is that hard? 100%? In order to find God, I'm going to give him 100%.
Come on.
Not 60, not 70, not 99, 99, or 99, but 100.
Come on.
At the cost of all other relationships and commitments. And I remember a couple days ago, Cain, he gave a very good analogy. It's like a marriage. It's like a marriage. So in a year, you got 365 days. Correct me if I'm wrong, okay? 365 days in a year. And he's like, "Hey, you know what? Seeking God is like spending 365 days with God." But people don't think like that. He gave this analogy. Like in a marriage, if a wife be like, "Hey, honey, I'll spend time with you 364 days of the year. And that extra day, I'm gonna go hang out with these other people. How would you feel?" And Cain was like, "No." People get that in marriages, in relationships, but they don't get that when it comes to God. Sometimes we treat people better than we treat God.
Yeah.
And when you are in love with someone, there is nothing you wouldn't do for them, including your time, money, and effort,
mm-hmm.
everything.
Yeah.
And the only way you do this is by spending quality and quantity time.
Mm-hmm.
How much time? Well, more than most people think. Well, in a week you have 168 hours in a week.
Mm.
What about giving 14 hours a week to God? 1 hour just reading His word, listening to God, and another hour just talking to Him, sharing with Him your feelings. Isn't that too much to ask for? And can you really say you are in love with God if you only squeeze like 20 minutes in the morning to pray and to read your Bible? And the sad thing is most people, they spend more time on YouTube,
mm-hmm.
on Facebook, in the gym, on the internet.
Yeah.
And for me, as a couple years ago when I was a young disciple, young Christian, I got this side business and I spent a lot of time on it. In the beginning, I thought I was able to balance like God and this business, but it didn't work out anyway. So basically, this business gradually dragged me away from God, slowly. It forced me to compromise my Wednesday night when we have a church gathering, and eventually Sunday services. And I was like, you know what? I'm hurting God. I'm loving money more than God now.
Mm.
And when I first got baptized, I told God that I'm going to put you number one no matter what.
Mm.
And when those brothers, when they told me the truth, I was like, oh my goodness, I need to repent. I need to change. And I made a radical decision. I dropped that business.
Mm.
I dropped that business. People, they call me, hey, Chi, you're crazy. That's your future. No. You don't know me. God is my future.
Come on.
The reason people are not passionate about God is that they don't invest the time to fall in love with God. It's simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
They don't invest enough time. Get to know the real God, not the one that you think exists. Because the God the Bible describes is very different than most of the views that we have in our minds.
Yeah.
Mm.
And most people, they don't know who God is. It is impossible to fall in love with someone that you don't know. Right? That's hard. How do we view God? Is He a police officer in your life? Is He just like standing there watching you with those super fly sunglasses, waiting to catch you like doing something dirty? Or is he a boss at work? You know, he tells you what to do and you guys have no relationship. Or would you call Him your best friend?
Mm-hmm.
Would you call Him your best friend? Which category?
Mm-hmm.
And most people's views of God are formed by false Christianity. People who are not Christians, false religions, and maybe even family. And that was certainly true of me. Before I became a Christian, I had a lot of religious friends. I mean, they go to like different churches and stuff. And because of them, I view God as boring and strict. And I think the saddest part is they never talk about God outside of church. But they told everyone they're passionate about Him. And I said, wait, hold on. I'm not even a Christian. But when I look at you guys, because of your passion or your love for God, I don't want to be like you guys. Their lack of passion turned me away from Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
And the other view that I had was that, hey, God loves us, so it doesn't matter what we do, right? So I started to abuse the love of God. I was chasing after sex, after money, but I still tell everyone I'm a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you got two very, very extremes.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the verses that really changed my view of God. Well, John 15. God is my friend. John 15, verse 14. Here the Bible says, well, it's actually Jesus talking. You are my friend if you do what I command. I no longer call you servant, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friend, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. What I'm going to share is a little bit silly, but don't laugh at me. I remember I wrote down a list of our qualities of what I would consider a friend. And I compare that, that quality with my relationship with God. Well, so let me share with you some of these qualities, okay? Well, someone who loves me for who I am. Someone who laughs at my jokes, even though they are not funny at all. Someone who puts up with me, even when I do stupid things, like jumping off a cliff. And someone that I am completely comfortable with, no matter what. And when I compared that list to God, my relationship with God wasn't there. So I made it there. And that is how God is, and I needed to believe that. And let's go to Romans 8, verse 1. Romans 8, verse 1. And this is another scripture that changed my view of God. Romans 8, verse 1. Here the Bible says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So let's start here. Well, here God says, hey, if we are a Christian, there is no condemnation in Him. But if you are not a Christian, well, there is condemnation. That is why you need to get right with God. Well, God made me who I am. I mean, I'm not saying I'm perfect. I'm far from perfect, just as Aaron. But God is okay with who I am at this moment. And He will change me as time goes on. And when the world tries to make me feel bad, I'll just go to God in prayer. Because I know He loves me for who I am. Let's go to 1 John chapter 4. And this is another crucial scripture that changed my view of God. 1 John chapter 4.
Come on.
1 John chapter 4, 16. And here the Bible says, and so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. So earlier I said, one of the views, I view God as like a police officer. And here this scripture really changed my mind because God is loving and He always will be.
Yes.
God is love. We need to rely on that love as Christians. The next time when someone tells you, hey, you are useless, or when you tell yourself that you're useless, stop it. Stop it. Do not believe it. Because that's not how God sees you. He believes in you. If you are a woman, and just look at how the world degrades woman.
Yeah.
If you are a woman, if you go read the book of Luke, you see the special ways that Jesus treats women.
Yeah.
And that's why in this church, we have this thing called Women's Day every single year, because we want them to feel appreciated. And we teach our men to respect women.
Come on.
Let's go to 1 Corinthians 13. What is love? Is it just a feeling? Is it, just that butterfly feeling in your stomach? 1 Corinthians 13, starting in verse 4. Here the Bible says, love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails.
Wow.
Well, so so in the previous scripture, it says God is love. And now let's swap the word love for God. And apply this scripture to your life.
Oh.
It says, God is patient with you. He's very, very patient with every single one of us. God is so kind to you. He does not envy you. He does not boast about how great He is so that you feel insecure or inferior. God is not proud towards you. He wants to have intimate fellowship with you. God does not dishonor you because of your sin or your weaknesses. God is not self-seeking, but He always seeks your good, always. God is not easily angered with you. which is a miracle with me. God keeps no record of your wrongs ever. He has wiped your past failings away for eternity. He does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. God always protects you and always will. He always trusts you, no matter how many times that you fall. He always hopes for the best of you. God will always persevere with you. God will never fail you. You see, when you understand who God is, then if anyone, your friend, your boss, whoever, your boyfriend, girlfriend, when they tempt you not to love God, not to put Him as your number one, to compromise your commitment to Him, just simply look at this scripture, show them this scripture, and ask them, are you willing to love me more than God loves me? Do they even have the power or capability to come close to loving you like God loves us? Let's go to Romans 8. Romans 8, verse 31. And so we talked about how do you fall in love with God. So what to do if you have fallen out of love with God? If you've been running away from God for the past, I don't know, years. In Romans 8, verse 31, here the Bible says, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors to Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Yeah. If you have been hurt, if you have had your heart broken by another human being, and if you allow that to damage your relationship with God, it's all your fault.
Yeah.
No matter how painful it is, it shouldn't affect your relationship with God. And just like, if you look at a married couple, and let's say the husband is like, hey, I want to divorce your wife, it doesn't give the wife the right to treat their children badly. Being hurt in a relationship doesn't give us the right to treat other people badly. Mm-hmm. Let's go to James 4, verse 7. James 4, verse 7. And here the Bible says, submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and He will come near you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your heart, you double-minded. If you have fallen out of love with God, and if you have been deceived by Satan, that the world is what you need, that the world can bring you satisfaction, it is time to change. It is time to submit yourself to God and resist the devil. Maybe you find great enjoyment in sports, basketball, football, music, whatever. But if it's not helping your relationship with God and your relationships with other people, then it's time to change. But go through your schedule today, this week, and cancel every non-essential thing and spend time with God in prayer, in Bible studies, and connect with Him.
Yeah.
Point number two, we must love others. So point number one, we talked about love God, right? And now we must love others.
Come on.
Let's go to Acts chapter 20. Well, Satan, he has put a great lie into our mind that if you put yourself first, you'll find happiness. That's why the world is so consumed with selfishness. And look at what does that do to the world.
Yeah.
But yet, this couldn't be further from the truth that Jesus preached. Acts 20, verse 35. The Bible says, "In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak. Remembering the word, the Lord Jesus himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.'" Loving others, that is the key to happiness and lasting motivation. And God has always taught a spiritual truth that living for other people is the root of happiness. Not only did Jesus teach it, he lived it so that we could imitate it. Well, let's look at what did Jesus give up. Heaven. He gave up heaven.
Yeah.
The place of peace and harmony with God. To come down and just get beat up, get persecuted.
Yeah.
He gave up a superstar lifestyle. With his power, his ability, he could have been the greatest businessman, singer, celebrity, sports player that he wanted on earth.
Mm-hmm.
But he wasn't interested
yeah.
in using his talent to find pleasure for himself.
Mm-hmm.
But instead, he did the opposite. He served people.
Yeah.
While he gave up his life, he spent his life focused on helping other people, teaching them to love
mm-hmm.
other people. And because of his lifestyle, it intimidated those around him, those religious people.
Mm-hmm.
And those religious people, just like what Dean said, they were so busy being religious. And they were so intimidated that they killed Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
They were like, no, we don't want to hear that anymore. Stop it, so we're going to kill you. They focus on destroying good instead of destroying evil.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus was all about promoting good
mm-hmm.
and hating evil.
Yeah.
And when you look at history, when you look at all these people out there, Jesus' life is still bringing joy and salvation to people today.
Mm-hmm.
And here I really want to lift up a couple people. I want to lift up Matthew.
Come on, Matthew.
I want to lift up Rhea.
Come on, Rhea.
I want to lift up Nikkei.
Come on, Nikkei.
These three people, these three young men and women, they've been bringing their friends out to Bible talk and to church.
Mm. Yeah.
And they are fired up about it.
Mm.
Because they are sharing, they know they are sharing the gospel of salvation
yeah.
with people who need it.
Yeah.
And one of the greatest motivations for myself to be a disciple is my parents.
Mm.
Even to this day, I know my parents, they are not going to heaven if they die today. So I must continue as a disciple in order to influence them.
Mm.
I gave up a lot of things to follow God because only he can save my parents.
Mm.
Well, let's look at some of the things that we do as disciples. Evangelism, going out there, talking to strangers about God.
Mm.
Well, for me, that's one of the greatest acts of self-denial. Because you are out there when it's super hot outside, super cold outside. You are out there trying to help people.
Mm-hmm.
You are trying to love them. And initially, I got nothing out of it. I mean, it was hard work emotionally and with so many rejections. But when you meet that first person who sees their need for God, and when you see the Bible changing their life,
mm-hmm.
their life being transformed in front of you,
mm-hmm.
and then they become your best friend, that's the best thing.
Yes.
It's more rewarding than however amount of money that you can accumulate
mm-hmm.
in your whole life. We're in Hong Kong. It's our first world city.
Mm.
We don't really see the pain of the world.
Yeah.
And therefore, we have no passion. We can lose that passion to help others
yeah.
or do great things for humility.
Mm.
But when you get involved in the lives of the poor, the orphans, when we allow our hearts to feel their pain, it motivates us to deliver justice. And I remember 2 years ago, I was in Manila for the first time. And I went to this orphanage with the church. And seeing all those little kids, 200 or 300 of them, innocent. Mm. But they were abandoned at very, very young age. Mm. And I still remember, they all stood up and they sang a song for us.
Wow.
And I started crying. Because I could feel all the pain that they've been through. And after studying the Bible with so many people, they tell you their stories. Depression, the desire to commit suicide, sexual abuse, all these things. You're going to start to feel the pain. Mm. And when you just look at us, we only see a tiny fraction of what God sees in heaven. Imagine how God feels every single day when he looks down from heaven and seeing everything. Mm. If you want the power to change you, your family, your friends, and this broken world, there are two things that you need to do.
Mm.
Number one, fall in love with God.
Mm.
How's your relationship with God?
Mm.
If you are not giving him 100%, then it's time to change.
Yeah.
The second thing is, we must love others more than ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
The world can only be changed if people start loving others. Are you willing to be like Jesus by loving others more than yourself?
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to wrap up with this one last passage, Mark 12. And I believe Jesus, he put it in the best way possible. In Mark 12, verse 29, here the Bible says, for Jesus, the most important one, answered Jesus, is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the first one. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than this.
Mm-hmm.
And I can guarantee you, when you start doing these two things, you'll change yourself, people around you, and eventually, you'll change the world, one person at a time. And to God be all the glory.